Myself, Asta Bodare. I am pursuing Masters in Community Health and Rehabilitation. Today, I am going to enlighten you something about multiple sclerosis. Now, let's see what is multiple sclerosis.
Multiple sclerosis. What is multiple sclerosis? Contents I'll cover in further slides will be definitions, epidemiology and etiology, pathophysiology, clinical manifestations, investigations, assessment and treatment. What is definition of multiple sclerosis? Multiple sclerosis is a chronic demyelinating disease of the central nervous system. What is introduction? Introduction includes disturbs ability of the nerve to conduct electrical impulses, leads to symptoms, usually affect young to middle age adults with onset between 20 and 40 years of age. How demyelination works in multiple sclerosis? This is the normal nerve fiber which consists of nucleus, dendrites, cell body, synapses, axon, nucleus here. This is the normal nerve fiber. After demyelination, when the myelin sheets get disrupted, the conduction from this end to this end gets delayed or hampered, due to which symptoms are seen. What is epidemiology? Epidemiology consists of this disease is a very rare in children, more common in women than in men. Multiple sclerosis predominantly affect white population. What is etiology? The precise etiology is unknown, but it is autoimmune disease induced by viral or other infectious agent, particularly herpes, chlamydial, pneumonia. What are the risk factors other than that? Genetic factors, infectious cause, environmental risk factors. How pathophysiology of the multiple sclerosis work? Myelin sheet. What is myelin sheet? It is a segmented lamination that wraps the axon of many nerve cells, and it increases velocity of nerve impulse conduction in the axons, characterized by chronic inflammation, demyelination and gliosis, scarring in the CNS. What is scarring? Scarring I'll explain you in the further slide. Initially triggered by a virus in genetically susceptible individuals. Subsequent antigen-antibody reaction leads to demyelination of axon. Here is the picture of how scarring works. This is the normal nerve fiber which is surrounded by myelin sheet. Myelin sheet is acts like covering which speeds up the conduction from this end of the nerve fiber to this end. After scarring, the myelin sheet gets disrupted. So the conduction cannot travel from this end to this end, and it gets delayed or slowed down in between, and the symptoms are seen. Now let's see pathophysiology in detail. Initially triggered by a virus in genetically susceptible individuals, subsequent antigen-antibody reaction leads to demyelination of axon. Then what happens? Disease process consists of loss of myelin, disappearance of oligodendrocytes and proliferation of astrocytes. Changes result in plaque formation with plaque scattered throughout the CNS. Initially, the myelin sheets of the neurons in the brain and the spinal cord are attacked, but the nerve fiber is not affected. Initially, only myelin sheets are affected, but the nerve fiber, which is deep inside, are not affected. So the symptoms are very less. But as the disease progresses further, patient may complain of noticeable impairment of function, myelin can regenerate and symptoms disappear, resulting in a remission. Then myelin can be replaced by glial cell tissue. Without myelin, nerve impulses slow down with destruction of axons. Impulses are totally blocked. As the axons are destroyed, the impulse cannot travel further, results in permanent loss of nerve functions. What is the clinical course of the multiple sclerosis? It consists of benign and malignant. Benign multiple sclerosis is characterized by mild disease in which patients remain fully functional in all neurological symptoms within the 15 years after the onset of the disease. But in malignant multiple sclerosis, which is also known as Marburg's variant, is characterized by rapid progression leading to significant disability or death within a very short time after the onset. What are the types and terminology of the multiple sclerosis? Let's see. First type. relapse remitting multiple sclerosis, which is characterized by relapses with either full recovery or some remaining neurological signs symptoms and residual deficits upon recovery. The period between relapses are characterized by lack of disease progression. Where the disease does not progress, it's known as relapse. And remitting is that the characterized or the symptoms are further reoccurred. Then comes primary progressive multiple sclerosis, characterized by disease progression from onset without plateaus or remission, or with occasional plateaus and temporary minor improvement, which progresses and progresses with time. This is known as primary progressive. Then comes progressive relapsing multiple sclerosis, which is characterized by progressive disease from onset but without clear acute relapses that may or may not have some recovery or remissions, commonly seen in people who develop the disease after 40 years of age. Then comes secondary progressive multiple sclerosis, which is also characterized by initial relapsing remitting course followed by progression at a variable rate that may also include occasional relapse and minor remissions. Here comes the figure which shows how disability progresses with time. In relapse remitting, relapse again remits, again relapse, plateaus are seen, then again relapse. In secondary progressive, the disease progresses, relapses, plateaus, relapses, then again it takes a stage where it goes on progressing. Then comes primary progressive, in which the disability goes on progressing with the time. In progressive relapsing, sometimes it relapses, then again it goes on progressing. What are the exacerbating factors? It is defined by new and recurrent MS symptoms that last at least 24 hours. It is associated with infection, major and minor stress event, pseudo-exacerbation, autopsy symptoms, internal external factor. Autopsy symptoms consist of unbearable extreme hot temperature which patient cannot bear. It's called as autopsy symptoms. Which are the clinical manifestations seen in multiple sclerosis? These are the manifestations seen. Motor manifestations, sensory manifestations, cerebral manifestation, emotional manifestations, bowel and bladder function, sexual dysfunction. Cardinal features. Which are the cardinal features seen in multiple sclerosis? It consists of Charcot's triad, which consists of intestinal tremors, scanning speech, and nystagmus. So it's known as Charcot's triad. What are the motor manifestations seen? Motor manifestations consist of weakness or paralysis of limbs, trunk, and head muscles. Movement are slow, stiff, and weak, that result of loss of orderly movement and reducing firing rate of motor neuron. Scanning speech, spasticity of muscle, and fatigue. Pain. What type of pain is experienced in multiple sclerosis? 80% of patients with multiple sclerosis experience pain that consists of trigeminal neuralgia, paroxysmal limb pain, abnormal burning, aching pain, headache, Lammert sign, hyperpathia, chronic neuropathic pain. Lammert sign consists of when the neck patient performs flexion of neck, a current-like sensation passes from his head till his limb. Then comes visual changes. What type of visual changes are seen? Involvement of optic nerve produces altered visual acuity. Blindness is rare. Optic neuritis, scotoma, Marcus Gunn pupil, nystagmus, intranictal ophthalmoplegia, diplopia. How optic neuritis is work? Optic nerve here is normal, as the myelin sheath is normal here. But as the myelin sheath gets damaged, the inflammation of the optic nerve is seen here, which causes optic neuritis. Here you can see that the conduction of the impulse is normal, but as the inflammation of the optic nerve, the conduction gets delayed. Sometimes it takes time to conduct. Then comes Marcus Gunn pupil. How is Marcus Gunn pupil work? Marcus Gunn pupils are equivalent first. Then the light on the good eye, afferent input which increases the pupils, then meiotic but equal. But as the light on the affected eye, then the afferent input decreases, both pupils dilate but still in equal. Sensory manifestations like anesthesia, paresthesia, disturbances of the position sense, particularly lower limb, impairment of vibratory sense. cerebral manifestations like postural intentional tremor ataxia are seen. Speech and swallowing difficulties like dysarthria, dyspnea, dysphagia are also seen. Ambulation and mobility. Difficulty in walking. Due to weakness, the patient feels fatigue, spasticity, impaired sensations, visual problem, ataxia, staggering gait, in uneven steps, poor foot placement, uncoordinated limb movements, and frequent loss of balance. Cognitive and affective. Pseudobulbar effect, euphoria, memory and recall problem, decreased attention, concentration, diminished problem solving, judgment, speed of processing are also seen. What are the bowel bladder functions affected? Constipation is seen, urgency, urinary urgency, frequency, nocturnia, incontinence, urinary hesitancy and dribbling are also seen. Sexual manifestations like impotence, decreased vaginal lubrications, impaired ability to achieve orgasm. Which are investigations performed in multiple sclerosis? CSF examination shows elevated total immunoglobulin in spinal cord and presence of IgG bands. Evoked potential shows abnormal conduction. Then MRI lesion shows lesions seen in bright spots. Which assessment part should be taken or what should be assessed in multiple sclerosis? Demographic data, which is common in almost all assessment part of physiotherapy. History, family history is must and medication history is must. Why? Because family history, because genetical it may also be caused due to genetic susceptibility. Medication history, I'll further explain why medical history or medications are important. On observations, on palpations, on examination, cognition, memory, bladder and bowel, cranial nerves, higher motor functions, then sensory in examinations, posture, balance, gait and locomotion, all part must be examined thoroughly. Advanced assessment nowadays consists of 9-hole pack test and box and block test. How it is performed and what is that, I'll show in further slides. Nowadays, using isokinetic dynamometry in ambulatory patients with multiple sclerosis, they have showed a strong evidence that it's very useful and it's reliable to use this instrument in ambulation. This is a 9-hole pack test which per patient performs and the time is noted in how much time the patient can complete. This is box and box test. Which are the scales to be taken in multiple sclerosis? Expanded disability status scale, multiple sclerosis fatigue impact scale, multiple sclerosis quality of life inventory, bulk balance scale, T-Natty gait and balance assessment, gait dynamic gait index, functional independence measure, 2-minute walk test, 6-minute walk test must be taken. Now comes the treatment part, which is very important part of the treatment, which consists of medical and physiotherapy, both. Medical management, disease modifying agents, corticosteroid therapy for spasticity reduction, baclofen, diazepam, carbamazepine, for pain relief, carbamazepine, diazepam, fatigue, amitriptyline, hydrochloride. Physiotherapy management consists of management of sensory deficits, management of pain, exercise training, management of fatigue, management of spasticity. Management of coordination and balance deficits, locomotor training, functional training, management of speech and swallowing, cognitive training. How are the sensory deficits and skills care taken in patients with multiple sclerosis? We should increase awareness of sensory deficits. Biofeedback should be given to them. Proprioceptive loading exercise must be encouraged to use the affected side so that the awareness and the function of the affected hand improves. Stroking, superficial and deep pressure strokings must be given. Approximation must be given related to functional task. Inflatable pressure splints, safety education program must be encouraged. Then comes management of pain. Pain relief through regular exercises, massage and ultrasound. Correction of any faulty pattern, hydrotherapy, pressure stocking and gloves, stress management techniques, relaxation techniques, medications, tens must be given. What exercises must be given? Exercises sessions scheduled on alternate days during optimal period, sub maximal intensity exercise prescribed. Circuit training, group exercise, resistant training mode include elastic resistant bands. How is fatigue managed in multiple sclerosis? Energy conservation techniques and activity pacing. As the patient complains of fatigue in this condition, so we should suggest patient that he or she should break his activity in smaller sessions so that he can get rest and the energy consumption level gets increased. How is the spasticity managed in this multiple sclerosis? Training strategies should be include activation of the antagonist muscles and local facilitation techniques can be added to activate weak antagonist muscle, and it is effective in reducing agonist tone through reciprocal inhibition. Elongation of spastic muscles, which should be maintained for 5 to 10 minutes. Sustained stretching, positioning, slow rocking exercises, ice packs, ES or vibration to antagonist, soothing verbal commands, inflatable pressure splints, cognitive relaxation techniques for trunk, rhythmic initiation or rotation in hook lying, PNF, splinting must be encouraged. Then comes how to control postural and functional mobility. Rolling, supine to sit, sit to supine, bridging, sit to stand, sit down transfers, standing modified plantigrade position, standing transfers, these are nothing but Frankel's exercise. How we can improve balance. Training includes varying ways of support. That support surface must be varied, sensory inputs must be given, upper extremity support position, upper extremity movements, lower extremity movements, trunk movements, destabilizing functional activities, environmental conditions, unexpected platform tilts. How is locomotion improved? Locomotion training, body weight support, treadmill activities, normal kinematics are performed. Gait training includes gait training in parallel bars, ambulatory aids, auditory and visual cues to maintain gait parameters, dual tasking, neuromuscular electrical stimulations, orthotics, AFO or KFO and wheelchairs must be prescribed in severe multiple sclerosis patients. Cognitive training, compensatory strategies of memory deficits, memory by making lists to do things, reminders, alarm clocks, bell timer, written direction of functional tasks, direction posted, differences, areas of home, mental exercise. Recent advances shows that long-term benefits of exercising on quality of life and fatigue in multiple sclerosis patients with mild disability. This evidence states that there is a good effect of exercise and very good effect of exercise on the quality of life and fatigue. But clear result was not seen in quality of life mental component, which varies from patient to patient, but a very good effect on fatigue was seen in this article. Same way, effect of rehabilitation of fatigue level in patient with multiple sclerosis, this also showed a very good result of exercise of some weeks. These are my references, and the treatment varies from patient to patient and according to the condition of the patient should be taken care, and then according to that the treatment of the physiotherapy must be planned and should be modified and should be according to the tailor-made. That varies from patient to patient and should be not imposed anything on all patients. Thank you.